So a few months ago, I wrote a blog post about creating a confined SSH login user domain using raw policy that still kind of integrates into the SE Linux policy that is provided in Fedora 18. So we could use this policy as a base for our graphical interface login user domain. This is basically that module, the type enforcement file. And we can basically just copy that over and edit it to reflect our base, so to speak. So I'll just copy this over into my guest because I'll be just experimenting in my guest, and I'll just create a new dir my login user cd my login user, and git init and nano my login user type enforcement file, and I'll paste this stuff in there. And we're going to basically adjust this module so that it basically fits our new scenario. And it's going to take a little work. I'm just going to go through it the hard way. Basically, renaming all this stuff manually, and then removing stuff that we don't need, or making it conditionalize stuff that we don't need. Because this is something that's going to take a long while, anyways. Just a huge task that I probably won't even finish because there are so many hurdles on the way to achieve a proper login user confined graphical user interface login user. So these are just the declarations that I did, and basically some simple stuff where we're basically allowing, and this should probably commented out. Or actually, this should probably be conditional. Comment it out. Let's just comment it out first. It's going to be a rather a mess. So my login user. Now this stuff is done. The basics is are those are the declarations, but it also takes care of some stuff that is needed to actually log in via SSH, some of it. And that's, for example, the transition rule from SSHD to SSH. Basically, SSH does a dynamic transition nowadays from SSH to the login user, and basically does so by calculating the path to the login user domain. And if that path is basically there, then it does it. So we need to basically add rules to basically make the path happen, and that's basically this rule. So we're basically going to implement a boolean here. And make this a tunable policy. conditional policy. So that basically that is conditional, the logging use, so that we can basically conditionally allow logging users, logging user SSH. Okay, so that's a little bit confusing, I understand. So basically my login user, this prefix with the domain with the module name, and then SSH enable SSH login, enable SSH login, because if this rule is not there, then SSH will not log in the user, and then SSH require SSHD, and then basically declare that boolean that's basically that, and then basically my login user. Enable SSH login. And by default it's false, set to false. So that's basically some conditional stuff, and I forgot to actually open the conditional. Or haven't I? No, I haven't. So I just did some wrong indents. This is the opening of the conditional. Alright. So, and this should probably go inside the conditional. And then we can remove the SSHD require. Oh, and where is it? Oh, it's here. From here. So that it makes a little bit more sense. And this can also be moved elsewhere inside the conditional. Because it's related to the conditional. And yeah, as for the role, I commented that out. The role allow system R access to change to the my login user R. I think it's related to SSH needing to change, but I'm not sure, so I'll just comment it out, and if it turns out that it's needed, then we'll see that about that. So now we made the SSH login conditional, and then the not so basics, let's see if that's all looking good. Yeah, and here we have SSH again, and let's see. Yeah. There's more stuff related to SSH. So we'll also make that conditional with the same stuff. So we don't have to declare the boolean anymore. We can just use it. So this should go in there. And right, so this can be removed. Oops. And then just for the sake of actually that should be fine. And then this should go, or actually we'll declare class fd use, put it in there, and then just and remove this line here because that's on the top, and then move this in there, and then just change that to reflect our new user, my login user, my login user. So that's also conditional. So let's keep changing these type names. Oh, and also this can be removed, these two. Okay, my login user. I'm just doing this manually because I want to review all these rules. Basically also explain I would ideally also explain all these rules. So this basically is where the login user is trying to read its own process state, which should be allowed by default or else stuff won't work. And this is that SSH stuff. And this is where basically the login user is allowed to echo to the terminal. The devpts actually, so this is probably just related to well, it's not just related to SSH, because if a user basically opens a terminal, a GNOME terminal, then it's also user devpts, I think. So that's, oops, this is already there, and here it needs to be able to find the sudo terminal devtti. This is also needed for some reason. Ptmx also needed for some reason, not exactly sure what for, but oh, and this needs to go up. This is SSH trying to create a key, so this also needs to go into the conditional. I'll just keep it. And then class key create IO control. Oh, actually, create, where am I? Search link write. Create search link write. And then we can basically remove that key create search. Right, and also the F file descriptor probably. And it needs to send a child terminated signal to init, because it's a child of init. Init needs to be able to read the process state of the my login user process. My login user. And so does syslog for some reason. So what we're doing is login user, we'll just expand this instead of syslog dtb. instead of basically doing it all separate. So it's a little bit rules, little rules. Syslog dt syslog dt, and then we can remove these. It's just the same. They're the same, right? And then we have, and again, some optional stuff. And then we'll just change the name. Okay. This is basically Numa D needing to be able to do particular stuff, for example, read system state of the login user, my login user. But also set scheduler, because that's basically what Numa does. It's basically assigning processes to CPUs, I guess. And the CD rules engines daemon, rule engine daemon, my login user support, just in case you have that running, we need to support that. My login user, login user, login user, need to basically set this up properly. And unconfined support, basically, if you have the unconfined module, we want the unconfined module to be unconfined also from the perspective of our confined domain. So unconfined domains should be able to see our process and basically read our process state, my login user. At least that's conditional. If you don't want to allow it, you'll be free to not toggle this boolean, or if you don't have an unconfined user domain. Also, yeah, it's actually optional and conditional. So, and then OKSM tuned also needs to read state. Also conditional. If you don't have KSM tuned running or installed or running, then you can disable this. But if you have it installed and enabled, then it will want to read all process state, including the my login user process state. And since we're not using as little global classifications as possible, so classifications that are declared in the SE Linux policy, we're just allowing it explicitly instead. So here we have a rule that allows our login user to basically execute hostname in the login user domain. Login user. And a shell. Now what we probably should do, because actually we should consider running that with a domain transition, although actually in this case, let's see what we have. I need to open my IDE. If we have a hostname dom trans, we probably do have that. So I'll just go to the ref policies, quicker, easier than changing branches all the time. So host name is probably, no it's not, system, yeah. yeah, here it is. So we probably do have a host named Dom Trance. Yeah, so we... Well, here we already... oh, we need a host name run, though. Well, here we already have an issue. Because if you're... Let's see if hostname actually runs something else. It doesn't, does it? Hostname doesn't run anything. So, because if it would have ran anything, then we would basically need a prefix domain transition, because we would need the program that hostname runs. We need to then make as a Linux let the program that hostname runs know that it's not actually hostname running the program, but the user running hostname running the program. But in this case, we could basically use hostname run instead. So what I'm basically going to do is, we're going to try and use raw policy. So we have this hostname dom trance, and it's going to get messy already. And I knew that would happen. So we're going to require type hostname key. Close that, and then require our role, my login user key, our role access to the hostname T. But then we also need to basically exactly, we can remove it from there. Host name exactly. Then we basically need to take care of domain transition. So the user is allowed to run generic shells in the user domain, but we need to make take care of mis patterns, I guess. So and then we have this dom trance pattern. That we need to basically write in a raw way. So S3 is in a dom trance pattern is the target, which is hostname T. S1 is my login user T, the variable one, and then the same for the other three, hostname T, my login user T, hostname T, my login user T. And then we need to take care of the other stuff. Oh, and yeah, we have the FD use, but and also this read write FIFO file is not right, so it's rather messy indeed. What do we have for FIFO file? So I'll just use that. because we are using raw policy. We're using raw policy, not any macros. At least we're trying not to do that. So this is already there, and the process is job terminated signal is also there, but we need to have the FDUs in the global requirements. We removed that because we thought it was only for SSH, but it's not. Now it's also for hostname, so we can remove it there. Okay. And now we basically need to go back and look at the domain auto transition pattern. Domain auto transition pattern, so we have this type transition here that we need to include. Oops. Where are we? So we're here again. So S1 was the my login user domain. S2 is the executable file hostname exactly. And the process as a parameter 3 or variable 3 is hostname T. And then back, we're going to have to take a look at the domain auto transition pattern. The domain transition pattern. Domain, so this one here, and these are the what we do need to take care of next. Copy, and then we took care of the whole transition in raw policy, so to speak. So we'll just add that above. My login user T needs to be able to run this file, the hostname exec T file, hostname exec T file. It needs to my login user T needs to be able to transition to hostname exec hostname T, the hostname process type. And we have a don't audit here, my login user T, hostname T. For the @secure, the no @secure, and the signal inheritance and resource limit inheritance. Now, hopefully that will build without actually, do we have a process transition required? And we don't, so we'll add that as well. Hopefully that will suffice. We'll see when we build it, when we try to build it. So now we took care of the hostname domain transition. Bootloader. This is basically just mmapping the file. Actually, it's either just mmapping the file or checking for execute. Either mmap bootloader executable. Files or testing for, actually it's not testing for execute, it's actually just mmapping the file, because if it was testing for execute then it wouldn't have to read it. Now this is actually a test for execute, since it's not even opening the file here. Okay, let's just change this. So I'll just make a comment and map. Test for execute. And then we have, oh, and also need to change the login user. Login user. And this is basically shared libraries and mapping them. So not actually executing them, but mmap. But that's with all shared libraries. This is mmap. And then we have the reading the cache, shared library cache, login. And then we have this basically executing generic libraries, which is also just executing mmapping. So no need for transitions there. So mmapping generic libraries. Now this one here, we're going to comment this out, or at least part of it, because we basically if we're going to confine the desktop, then we have to probably going to have to confine a lot of commands that are currently generic. But if we allow this, then we won't even see it when the user runs generic programs that we're going to maybe want to confine later. So we're going to just for now comment that out, and eventually we might consider allowing that, but preferably not, because we want to confine this stuff really really good. Login user, this is reading hardware data. Locale. It's basically the same, so we can basically just what we can basically do is use brace expansion again. Locale T. Locale T. Make it the policy a little bit more compact, because this policy is going to, if this is going to be anywhere nearly finished, then this policy module is going to be huge. And it's going to take an Einstein to actually read this policy and find your way in this policy. It's going to be like 50,000 lines or something, not sure. Reading inheritance login inherited password files. Reading generic proc files should be allowed, like meminfo. So if you run a shell, oops, then it wants to read proc meminfo. Reading security, this is get enforce. My login user. Basically, it needs to read some SE Linux stuff. That's no problem either. SSFS is also probably just needed. Generic user files. Reading it. So that's just the reading stuff in a user local or user share or whatever, user in user. which should be just readable. And this is reading generic etc files. And this is a little bit fucked up, but on the other hand, since we're confined in the user space, we should probably just make a note. Deal with this, because basically, currently a lot of stuff is labeled with the etc underscore t type that should really be protected, and especially from local users. So although it's not a first priority to basically protect the files that users try to read, we should eventually consider that. And this stuff here needs to go into the conditional. In the SSH conditional. This is basically only applicable if the user logs in via SSH. Just going to datagram socket. Oh, this sucks. Datagram socket write, Unix stream socket read write, and TCP socket. Yeah, so that TCP socket really needs to go. Here, now the Unix datagram socket write we need to remove that write from there and put it in here. And then only write, require only write, because trying to make this as clean as possible, as readable as possible. And then the Unix stream socket read write. Unix stream socket read write. Okay. Where were we? Okay, so we're here. So this is basically the following is basically access to user home. I guess I could call it initial access to the home disk, because this basically provides only the simplest access to user home disk, just generic user home disk login user, and that's probably a good thing. Probably a good thing. And then we have this transition. Yeah, we should probably extend that to FIFO files, name pipes, and maybe even SOC files, and yeah, maybe even character notes and block file notes for if a user basically use the mk note command in its home directory. But for now, this should suffice. The most common things a user creates. Oh, this is a duplicate. This is a duplicate rule. And then we have the others. The most common things. Why would we actually require that? These are things that we are going to remove because we're not going to support sudo, and at this point we just can't silently deny. This is our silently deny don't audit rules, and we can't at this point we can't basically hide anything. We need everything to basically troubleshoot our policy, because this is basically the start of a real long trip. So let's see if this even builds. Of course it doesn't build. Unknown type SSHD def PTSD. So that's here, this one. It's not required. We need to require it. And we need to remove it if it's here. And we did remove it from there. But we need to basically add it here. And we're probably going to be seeing a lot more stuff that we need to fix. Unknown type, typo here on line 172. This is line 1, 172. This is line 85. And this is too high. And this is where it's the typo occurred. It's not moo, it's my. And this is how we troubleshoot simple errors. Alright, so build. Let's just see if it installs. Sudo etcmodule I, and then my login user pp. Basically, the goal here is to just basically make this stuff work a little bit in the just the normal way, just for SSH users. Just make sure that basically we just basically need to be able to log in using this this domain, and that won't work because we removed the bint. We basically commented out the rule where users allowed to run generic binary files, and probably the user should probably be able to do that to be able to log in at all. And basically, what we did was make some stuff conditional, like that SSH login conditional and stuff like that. And we removed some rules and we cleaned up a little bit. So the goal right now is to just basically make it a SSH login user, and then basically build on that later for a graphical user interface. But first things first. So let's go back to the blog post and see what we need to do to set this up. So basically we need to install it, then we need to create a file. So we'll do that. And that's just support for SSH. So let's go to a, oops, this is not where I'm supposed to be at. Do we have a root shell? Yep, we do. CD etc se linux targeted, and then it's contacts users list. Oops, and I've been making a stupid typo right there. LS, and then basically nano a my login user underscore u file, paste this stuff in there, and then just change that to reflect the my login user u login user login login user my login user my login user. And then this login user, well, we'll just allow it login, or we just specify it. But you could basically, if you are not allowing SSH logins, then you can basically remove this, comment this out. So I'll just make a comment. Only needed if you allow SSH logins. Just for basically, oops, for documentation purposes. Alright, so what do we need to do next? We need to add a user without any and beware for typos. And we don't need sudo because we're in a root shell. Okay, well, that's compiling. Okay, so now basically we need to add a user, set it up. Make sure that the user can log in. So user add my login user password my login user then we need to take care of some groups. Groups my role. SSH user, so user mod A G SSH users group 2 and that's for my login user. And we need to comma this, comma separate this. I think so. My login user, and I'm doing something wrong, that's the G, need to dash that. Okay, so now what I need to do is, let's look at home, my role, SSH, out. I need this, no, it's not in there. I need my key, my smart card key. What else do we have? LS home. No, I, my, it's probably SFTP only user. Oops, SFTP only user. And it's also not, Jesus, I know I added it somewhere, so I'll just use Dominic, it's done, it's probably there, it should be. And it's not there either, Jesus, use Grift. I thought I guess not. try my iZed, man. That's stupid. Okay. I'll just use it locally. Or hopefully I even have it locally. Nope. Oh yeah, here it is. This one. Okay, back. So basically, CD or L, yeah, CD home. And with a little luck, the my login user, yeah, CD my login user make their SSH CD SSH nano authorized right keys. Then push that, paste that in. That's my smart card SSH key if all is well. Gmod 600, I guess. Out. And then Gmod 700 for that. Gmod 700 SSH down my login user my login user SSH but recursive. And basically remove that Mozilla dir rm dir Mozilla, because that's, I don't know why they installed that by default. It's not empty even. Oops. Rf ls all. Okay, restore con r v f home my login user was it, wasn't it? Login user. And oh yeah, we didn't map it yet, so we need to actually map it. So as you manage login a as my login user, u is the as a Linux user, the range is just as zero, no categories in other words, and then my login user, and it'll take care of the mapping. So we no MCS support, and then try that restore con again, and now it resets. And let's see if we can actually log in. Actually, we need to take care of booleans. So get sc bool and then all, list them all, and then grab my login user. Then we'll see all the booleans related to my login user. So we have this the booleans that we declared. So basically we need to enable the SSH login, and we need to add support for various oh, and basically unconfined support is enabled by default. CD rules engine daemon, probably don't need that, but well, I'll just enable them all. Not a big deal, it's just reading process state and NUMA setting scheduler. So set SE bool and then persistent, and then we'll just do them all in one run, because else it would take too much time. Paste, and then is one, and then paste. Is one and paste. Is one And the final one is Numa. And I'm not going to do that one. Now, in theory, this should work, but it won't. Probably, it's most likely won't, because we commented out. I commented out where System R is allowed the my login user access to the my login user underscore R role, and we're probably going to need that for SSH. I'm almost certain that we're going to need that for SSH. I'm just 100% certain, but I don't know why I commented that. And of course, it can't run binary files. So if the user needs to run some generic binary just to log in, then it will fail as well. So let's just see what happens. New shell, SSH. And then my log. Oh, and actually, there's more I need to take care of. I need to take care of nano, etc, security, access conf. Because by default. Everything except what is specified is prevented. So this now should probably work, or probably work, not work, but we should have probably now taken care of a lot of stuff. So that's SSH netkb info. Oops. And we have some errors, so let's fix those. Let's just till N 500, because there's a lot of stuff in my audit log. Audit grep I se linux r, and it's audit log. Probably not this. No. So there's no SLinux R. Outsearch MAVCTS to recent, and then just pipe that to audit to allow. And you'll probably see a bin, something related to bin, or you might actually see something related. No, nothing related to bin. So why did it fail? Less var log secure. Unable to get valid context. Get SE bool grab my login user. SSH support is enabled, so we have some issues related to our default context, it seems. My login user you nano my login user view. Seems okay. Let's just comment that out, see if that comment caused issues. May well be, but no. My login user, so I made some error somewhere. Let's have a look at what else. So let's say, let's do the cat my role you, see if no, that should be fine. Default context should be fine. Okay. Then I think it's really related to that system R stuff. But I'll just double check as you manage user L grab my login user. Just double check that. But I think it's really related to system R. This seems to be all fine. Then also do the login. And this is also fine. So I'm just assuming this is related to the role, so let's just try that. So here we basically allow the system R role access to the, and if that isn't allowed, then basically SSH won't be able to use it. So we'll just add that to the conditional. Other login programs need this as well though, but and this, so this is basically shouldn't basically be in this conditional, and this stuff can probably be conditional. But this is also for SSH in this case, but probably can't be conditional. Okay. And now we have seems this can't be conditional either. Oops. Or did we just make a mistake? Let's try this again. Yeah, it can't be conditional. Seems that it can't be oh right, there is a bug there as well. Not sure why this is, but let's just make it unconditional. Let's just make it unconditional. There are some strange behavior when it comes to conditionals. put that there as well. Now it does build. So it seems that that stuff can be conditional. Now hopefully this fixes that login. Oh, I had my caps lock on. That doesn't help. Let's see if we can log in then. Probably needs to calculate, it's probably part of the calculation. Basically it's calculating whether it can go from the SSH context to the user context, and if it can't for some reason then it craps out, and probably also does a check on whether it's allowed from to go from system R, which is the system role for SSH, to the my login user R, which is the login user role. So that's probably it. So let's see if it is, if it's that. Yeah, that's it. But we do have some other issues. Could not change there to my login user. So that's basically because of the Binti stuff. And that's basically why we need to make this domain a permissive domain for now. So if I do out search recent, then you probably see that it won't be allowed. It wasn't allowed to run generic binary files. The see, oh, root T. So let's just allow that. It needs to traverse root directory and the slash directory, so to speak, not the root directory, or it is the root directory, but so let's just add that as well. All below. Traverse root, and so require type root T and then insert that and then see where that gets us. But I guess something eventually you also need to basically run the generic binary files to even do an ls or a cd or stuff like that. Shoo, let's try this again. It's all about testing. Right, so I'm logged in, but I can't run id with, because that's a generic binary file. So if you now look, then it's, oops, not allowed to. So now you have a shell, but you can't do anything. You can't run any commands. Funny. So here you have that. This ABC is allowed in the current policy. And here it tries to traverse var for some reason. It's trying to traverse SSH home. And this is not allowed. So here is trying to execute generic binary files, and then because it basically can't execute it, it's going crazy. It's going to, it's going into a panic mode, and then it's trying to list the binary dir. Because basically first it tries to blindly exec idid command, and then it returns permission denied, and then it says what? Panic, 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 panic. So just let's just list the directory and see if I can find anything that closely resembles it. But it does isn't allowed to list it as well. The binary there, the user bin there, and then it basically just craps out and says, okay, fuck this shit. Okay, so it's not allowed to basically search SSH home. It's not strictly needed, but we need to basically allow the user to deal with content in the home direct in the SSH directory. And I'm not sure why it's trying to traverse var. Let's see if the grep var t. Bash is trying to traverse far. So we should allow that as well, probably. So first take care of SSH. So here we have, so basically we can basically make that conditional as well. So require, actually let's just not make that conditional, let's just allow that. We're going to allow some, make some rules here. So first we'll allow my login user SSH home key, and we need to require that type to basically, actually I'm just going to copy these over, KK U and then U, and then change that SSH home key basically, so that the user can basically manage files, SSH home key manages SSH files. And then we also need to make a type transition here, and we will do the name type transition, type transition my login user t, and then user home dir t, and then for dirs not sure if this is the right syntax, home key, then SSH, see if this is the right. So basically what we're saying to SE Linux is when my login user t creates a dir in user home dir, t dirs, which is basically the user home dir, with the name dot period SSH, then transition from, then transition from user home dirty to SSH home key, and there basically the user is allowed to do stuff to the user home, traverse and var, and then I'll say bash. I'm not sure why bash is trying to traverse it, but and we'll see later. Var t, and then just make that extend that. Not sure what bash is trying to do in var, but it's probably related to the panic mode that it can't execute bin. And then we need to require the user of the SSH home key type. And var. Var and SSH home t. So the var, the root t was already required, but didn't actually allow to traverse. Oh, that's probably due to don't audit rules. Let's see where we get, where this gets us. Now the shitty thing here is that I can't currently log out. I can't run the exit command. So I need to go into a permissive mode to actually exit the shell. the SSH login, because I can't currently. So I'll just sudo setenforce0, then basically log out, then I'll be able to log out. Exit. See? And now I'll setenforce1 again. And I'll just have to make this a permissive domain anyways, but this is just for testing. Okay, so let's see if we have new ABC denials. Var run. And here it's trying to send audit messages, which we should ignore for now. But it's basically now reading var run. Let's see, that is bash again, grep var run. See, that's bash again. It's trying to traverse run. So let's just allow that as well. Type var run t. Let bash traverse that. Oh, and we can remove these requires. Allow my login user, and I think it probably wants to get to login we're probably going to see a lot more of this main file read. Because it's not doing that for nothing. It has a reason. It probably has a reason, and then we need to basically set up for 0 again to log out. Set up for 0, log out, exit. And then set and force 1 again. Actually, we can just look at what it's going to. Actually, we can't. That's a shitty thing. We can't test in permissive mode yet because we want to know what it takes to run a shell without allowing the executing of bin at all. That's what we want to figure out. Okay, so that's what something that needs to be done as well. A lot of work just to figure out what it takes to log in without access to generic binary files. But if you're not in a hurry and, well, then it's just nice to figure out what certain things are needed to make things happen. So now we set a 4-0 to log out again. And then 4-1 again. see what it is now that it needs. I'll search again. This is the drill, the same drill. And seems that's it. It just wants to, for some reason, traverse far run. That's it, basically. And these can be, these two can be ignored because they should eventually be don't audited if possible. And this can be ignored because we need to be able to see. So now, for example, let's just for fun, see if we can exit. And that actually worked. And how? Why is that? Are we in permissive mode? Get and force. We are in a forcing mode. The exit command. Oh, is maybe that's a building or something. LS user bin grab exit. That's a built-in. Oh, actually it's a built-in, so that's cool. Anyway, so now we have a basis here. Now basically you can, if you basically get SE bool. Let's just first try logging in again. So now it works, takes a little while because it can't find stuff, and so this stuff, the LS, can't do anything. And then this is basically exit. And now we're going to set that SSH enable boolean and then see if we still can log in. So grab my login user and then disable this in memory. Set SE bool and then off. And it should go fast because it's not persistent. Yep. And then see if. And now see, now we can't log in and able to get valid. So that's basically how we make that conditional, the SSH login user permission. So that's cool. That's a neat feature, I think, in my view. So, and now back to on. So this is basically, I'll leave it at that. So now we have basically a very, very minimum login SSH login user, where actually the login via SSH is also conditional, so you need to set that boolean. And also this user cannot execute generic binary files, so that's neat. So it can't do anything, so it's really not useful. But we really need to basically deny access to generic binaries, because we need to be able to see what it's actually trying to execute, so that we can determine whether we should confine whatever it's trying to execute. So now we'll make it permissive, because we determined that we have everything we need to basically log in. And now make it permissive so that we can basically start troubleshooting stuff. And that will end the first chapter of our endeavor to basically confine GraphQL user interface login users. When we're far from even close, but anyways, so that's it, part 1.